स्टार्ट करें।
हाँ स्टार्ट।
सो गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, आई एम डॉक्टर मीनाक्षी रावत एंड टुडे वी विल बी टेकिंग द क्वेश्चन एंड आंसर राउंड फॉर बेसिक्स ऑफ सॉफ्टवेयर डिफाइंड रेडियो एंड प्रैक्टिकल एप्लीकेशंस। सो टिल यस्टरडे वी हैव कलेक्टेड सम ऑफ द क्वेश्चंस एंड फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी विल स्टार्ट विद दोस क्वेश्चन एंड आंसर्स एंड देन आई विल लुक इनटू योर क्वेश्चंस व्हिच यू आर सेंडिंग टू मी ऑन चैट एंड देन आई विल रिप्लाई टू दोस। सो लेट अस शेयर द स्क्रीन। So first question which we received was, if we are doing undersampling, can we reconstruct the signal? I think we would not reconstruct it, then how can it be advantageous? So to go into the answer of this question, let's go into the basics of undersampling first of all. So if you remember, the Nyquist criteria was that if we have to digitize a signal, then we have to use a sampling rate that is at least twice of the bandwidth of the signal. So in this, on the screen you can see that the bandwidth of the signal is B, and because it is a baseband case, it means the highest frequency component is also B here. So for the case where we are talking about the baseband signal, we don't have any problem because Nyquist criteria follows and we are able to get the signal easily. Now the point about the reconstruction. So if you look at this diagram, if this is a signal which is band limited signal, we can call it f in max, or we can call it bandwidth because it's a baseband signal. If this f in max is within fs by 2, it means it is following the Nyquist criteria, then we can see that every fs, after every sampling frequency duration, the signal repeats itself. Right, and for the duration from zero, from the duration from fs by 2 to fs, if you look here, we get the same signal, but it is inverted because it is fs minus that frequency. But in this case, we have no interference from the aliasing component, so we can simply filter our original signal here, and we can reconstruct because there is no aliasing there. Now in the second diagram, we are showing what will happen if f in max is actually more than fs by 2. So as we can see here, that in this case, we will be having an aliasing, which is coming from the component, which is the inverted form of the original signal in the band fs by 2 to fs. So that was the concept for the baseband. Now the question which was asked, that what is the advantage of the undersampling? The advantage of the undersampling, it comes into picture when we go to the band pass sampling. So the oversampling which we covered in the course, that finds its application for the baseband case when our signal is lying within the first Nyquist zone, that is 0 to fs by 2. In that case, if we oversample it, then the replica will fall very much outside. It is far much away because fs is quite high, so we have relaxed criteria on the filter. In the case of band pass sampling, what is happening? That the band of my signal is still B, but the lower frequency of that signal is A. In this case, if you see, the band is actually bandwidth of the signal is B, but the highest frequency component we can say is A plus B. So the question rises, should the sampling frequency depend on A plus B or B or some other frequency? So there comes the criteria of the undersampling and the application of the undersampling. So in this case, we have to choose our sampling frequency very carefully. So how do we do so? It is clear that if I want to choose my sampling frequency as twice of A plus B, then it will be a very high value for the sampling frequency. So my D2A has to support them that much high sampling frequency. It has to be very fast D2A or A2D. Now what we can do alternatively, and I'm giving one example, and this example was covered in the lecture note also. I'm taking a signal which has a bandwidth B, And its highest frequency component, it lies at 3B. It means its lower frequency component is lying at 2B because bandwidth is B. So in this case, let's see what will be other components, aliasing component. So this is the positive frequency component. So of course, there is a negative frequency component. Now we know that at every sampling frequency, the signal repeats. So here we are putting F plus minus FS. So this signal is repeating at FS, which is 2B. So this FH plus 2B is here and FL plus 2B is here. Now F minus FS, this will give you this component. For this one, the positive complex plus FS is giving you this component and minus FS is giving you this component. If I take only third Nyquist zone, that is after FS. Now if I go to the fourth Nyquist zone, that is after 2FS. So what is happening? That it is, this component is beyond 4B. So FH plus 4B is here, FL plus 4B is here. Similarly, minus 2FS, this component because of the minus has gone here. This component because of the plus has gone here. Because of the minus, it has gone here. Similarly, for 3FS, this component is coming here, plus 3FS. And this component, because of minus 3FS, is going there. The plus 3FS component is going beyond the scope of this diagram, basically, right? So if you see all this component, and we can imagine if I do plus minus 4FS, then it will move further and it will move further. So keeping all this component in mind, this is the last diagram where we are adding all the aliasing components. And we can see here that the original signal, it is falling here, here, here. It means first Nyquist zone, third Nyquist zone, fifth Nyquist zone, very similar to what we will expect in the baseband case. So this is the example of undersampling because we have used my bandwidth as B and my sampling frequency was 2B, but my highest frequency component was 3B. So if I say that my bandwidth was 20 megahertz, my sampling frequency was 40 megahertz, then my highest frequency component was 60 megahertz. And what will be the IF? IF will be somewhere in between, which will be 50 megahertz. So this is one example of the undersampling. What we have seen that by using even the smaller sampling frequency than the highest frequency component, we are able to get our signal and reconstruct it because there is no overlapping with the aliasing components. So this case is when our maximum frequency component is a multiple of B. In that case, we are able to get the baseband replication. But suppose it is not a multiple of bandwidth, then we have to be careful in choosing these distances. So in this case, we have to see that with that sampling frequency, where this component will lie, the shift. And what is the distance between these two? Is aliasing occurring? So because of that, this kind of diagram, if you go to any communication book, you can find the concept of bandpass sampling. You will find this diagram, which shows the forbidden region where it will not work, how you can choose your FS, and the reason where you can choose this. Analytically, you can choose that sampling frequency yourself also by placing the aliasing components plus FS, plus 2FS, plus 3FS components. So that was the answer, that undersampling is useful in the case of bandpass sampling. Now, if I summarize this, basically your ADC and DAC, they are of two types. If you're going to use a baseband sampling, then you have different kind of ADC, DAC. And if you're going for the passband sampling or the bandpass sampling, then you have different kind of ADCs. So please pay attention, if your data is near zero IF, if it is near the baseband, then your ADC bandwidth will be low, because your data is always near zero IF. But depending on the actual signal bandwidth, your sampling frequency may be high or low. For the bandpass sampling, because your data is actually now at IF frequency, not zero IF frequency. So ADC bandwidth has to be high in every case. But should it use a high sampling rate, That depends on actual signal bandwidth, which you will choose by placing, looking at the region when it will not clash with its aliasing components. So I hope that I answered the question there. Now let's go to the next question. This question was asked in the forum. After the modulation of the wave, the signals are not in the form of pulses. It will be in the form of sinusoidal. Then again, why do we need to do the pulse shaping? So I think it is a good question because somehow we skipped a little portion there. What we covered in the lecture was, and this is the recap from the lecture, if we have any signal in the rectangular shape in time domain, and we take its frequency, we convert it into frequency domain, then we find a sync function. And vice versa. Vice versa, it means when we have any rectangular pulse in the frequency domain, it should be a sync function in the time domain. So this relation holds, and this is what we covered in the in our lectures. But what we didn't cover, like being asked, that basically we have done the modulation. So our signal is not pulse exactly. Now it is kind of sine. So why it is relevant? So now we are trying to answer that question. So basically, once we do the modulation, let's say it is BPSK, QPSK, or QAM, what we are trying to do is change the amplitude and the phase. So that is defined by the bits, one and zero positions, and how you crowd them together, how you make the symbol. So because the symbols themselves are ones and zero, so it is on and off situation. So in the first diagram, in the time domain, if you see, this is how it looks. Sudden change in some phase and some amplitude, and these changes we can see here by yellow markers. These abrupt changes are happening because our pulse is actually rectangular. Now our aim is to make that rectangular pulse more less abrupt. So that's why we are using that root trace cosine filter, which I discussed in the lecture. After applying that filter, if you see the time domain waveform, it becomes smooth like this. So these discontinuities, they are following the trend, but they are smooth. They are not abrupt. So because of the gradual changes, abruptness goes. In the time domain, it looks like this. In the frequency domain, without pulse shaping, this is the frequency response. So I have taken this data from the actual measurement system, and I refer you to this link which I am showing on this slide. This is from the NI, and I have taken because it was a very good example from the practical measurement systems. You can see that we have the high data here, but most of the energy is being dissipated in the neighboring channels, and this is happening because we didn't use any filter and we were using rectangular pulses, abrupt changes. So because of that, same kind of response is there. Now after using our RRC, we can see here that our most of the energy is contained in the band where I want to send a signal, and out of band is much attenuated. So that is the response in the frequency domain. So I hope with this the answer is clear to you. Now I got one question today morning. Where can I find different radio cognitive algorithms? So first of all, I want to clarify that this course is about software-defined radios. We covered the hardware aspect, the radio aspects. Cognitive radio algorithms are completely different aspect. In that, you are either talking about the spectrum sensing techniques, or you are talking about the spectrum interference, or some other aspect of the cognitive radio. So that you're talking about the networking and the relation between those two. So I'm providing you two references. They are not the only references, but they can be the starting point. And I believe it will be a kind of research topic. You have to start from this. The first reference, it has been cited so many times in the patents and the papers that I'm giving to you. Similarly, the second one, please use this reference as the starting point. And again, it is not very relevant to this course. So next question, please explain how, because of quadrature component, FC minus FM is causing distortion and has a less magnitude. So I think when you are asking this question, you are referring to the IQ imbalance. So I'm taking this slide again from the lecture notes. If you see here, the baseband signal, which is made of the quadrature component and the in-phase component, it is represented like this. If we don't have any IQ imbalance and they have the exact relation of 90 degree and their gain is not hampered with, then in the analog domain, the data which we see is real value of the x e to power j 2 pi fc t. Fc is the carrier frequency. Now, this is carrier frequency if we are using directly to the carrier frequency of the transmission. But suppose we have IF stage, then this FC is replaced by FIF, that is small frequency. So in this expression, the output becomes XI cosine 2 pi FIFT minus XQ sine 2 pi FIFT. And as you can see, it is real value data, but it depends on both the components, XI and XQ, and they have the phase difference between the data also. So the y either can be represented by this equation or that, which will give you the same answer. The thing is that when you have IQ imbalance, then this relation does not hold because there is some distortion. And this is what we are showing you, that let's say instead of XA, it is reading the gain as 1 plus alpha XA. That alpha can also be negative value if it is representing attenuation in the path. But main thing is that it is not representing XQ, not XA. It is not representing XQ exactly. Similarly, this theta is a deviation from the 90 degree. So this deviation is, in practical cases is very small because the fabricator of those quadrature modulator, they try to maintain the 90 degree relation. But due to the fabrication process, etc., some small deviation, 1 degree, 2 degree, 3 degree might happen. It will not be very, very high deviation. So that is why some small deviation happens, and because of that, some component fall extra in the in phase and the quadrature phase. They impact each other. So because of that, it was shown using a derivation that basically our output in the time domain, it becomes a function of xt into some coefficient plus j, some coefficient x conjugate t. So if you see here, if this k2 is equal to 0 and this k1 is equal to 1, then my yt is xt, which we want. So basically what we can say from this equation here is that this conjugate term is the one which is representing phase and gain imbalance, because when it goes down, then it is simply the input signal with some coefficient. So that is why we say that this is appearing at the conjugate. When we say conjugate, so it means if e to the, if we go back, if we are saying e to power j 2 pi FIFT, so conjugate will be e to power minus j 2 pi FIFT. So that's why it falls on the negative side near the zero frequency. Or when it is upconverted, it becomes on the negative side of the carrier frequency. Because of that, if no imbalance, you will get the original data. If you have IQ imbalance and you do the extraction at the receiver end, then you will be having this imbalances. And this imbalances in the constellation diagram will appear like this. And if you plot the frequency component, and this FM here is intermediate frequency, FIF. So this is what I was saying, that FC plus FIF was your original signal. Its conjugate, which will be minus of that, will fall here. So please remember, initially, when we were using a quadrature modulator, this FC used to be zero, right? So then it was plus FIF and minus FIF. Then upconversion happened when we were trying to transmit it to the transmitting frequency, and then FC added to both of them, right? And we know that IQ imbalance is a small amount because it is unintentional small error. So that's why it is small, practically. So, but of course, if you will introduce IQ imbalance in a very high quantity artificially, so of course you will see that it is increasing, and it will come very at par with the original signal. But practically, it doesn't happen because this is not what we want. But it appears like this. Now, the point here was that it is smaller than this one, but still, if the difference between this and this is not qualifying the criteria set by the TRI, the agency which decides that what should be the out-of-band distortion levels, then we have to remove this portion, or we have to suppress it a little bit, right? So in the case of heterodyne, because we can see that FIF is far away, we can filter out the original signal, and discard that one, suppress this one. But in the homotidyl structure, because FIF was zero, so it means this is here and this is also here. It is with, hidden within this. So in this case, we have to resort to some of the digital processing tactics, because filter cannot help us, because my signal is hiding within this. So what can be the way to identify it? You plot the original signal and the capture signal, the error between these two, and that error should be mostly this image, which is hiding inside it. So I hope that I have answered your question, that how, why it is small and why it is falling at FC minus FIF or FC minus FM, where FM is the intermediate frequency. So one question was, during conversion from digital to analog domain, does this frequency spectrum of the original message signal remains conserved? So of course, because the aim is to keep the same time domain data, so the ideally frequency spectrum is conserved in the in-band data. But what happens that because the system has the noises, A2D, D2A filter noises are there, you have noise figure of each component of the path. So basically noise floor is much, much higher. It means if I have made this signal in the digital domain, it will go much below, maybe 300 dBc ACPR in digital domain. But because I'm capturing from a measurement system, so you can see that it is not 300, it is small. And I'm giving one example that mostly you will find that DAC, ADC are of the bits 12 bit, 14 bit, and maximum 16 bit. So for 14 bit system, theoretically, if you apply the formula 6.02 into N plus 1.76, so we get 86 dBc, theoretically possible. It means it is the maximum limit. And that is only when you don't have band pass signal. You have only a single carrier, single tone signal. So of course, when you are sending a broadband signal, that power is distributed in all the frequencies, it even goes down. So in this diagram, which I am showing here, this is the measurement noise. This is what I'm seeing, out of band noise. In digital system, it will be much lower. In practical systems, it will be higher. And if you have other distortions like PA, et cetera, then you can see them appearing here. So I hope that I answered your question here. So one question was, why for transmitter RF plus LO frequency is taken and for receiver RF minus LO frequency is taken after mixing? So first of all, I want to clarify, it is not a hard and fast rule that you have to take RF plus LO. Whenever you're mixing any component, you will have two components, FLO plus FIF and FLO minus FIF. You can choose whichever you want, but because we are trying to upconvert something, so it is more feasible if I take the higher component and choose lower LO, because as you go to higher frequency, the cost of component goes higher. So generally we say FLO plus FIF is the RF signal, but it is not a hard and fast rule. FLO minus FIF can also be taken. In that case, you have to filter out the another component. Similarly, once you have a signal in the air and the receiver side, if you have signal FLO minus FIF, then what you have to do is actually take the component, because the LO will be used with the mixer, FLO minus this FRF. Because in that case, you will be getting FLO minus FLO plus FIF. So you will be getting FIF, which is your aim. You want to get back to the IF frequency. Because at the IF frequency, your A2D and D2D, D2A works, which we have covered in that complete undersampling question there already. So if your RF signal is FLO plus FIF, then you want to do this minus FLO. So again, because here you're using a mixer, again, you will be having two components, this plus this and this minus this. So you can choose whichever component will give you FIF. So I hope that I answered your question correctly here. It is not a hard and fast rule. But we try to choose a small value of FLO. So sometimes for the up conversion, we say that it is FLO plus FIF. And for receiver, we say it is FRF minus FLO, because then we have to choose smaller value of the LO frequency. One question was, can anyone let me know what will be the effect on output power of power amplifier if input signal power is getting increased by 1 dBm? So it actually depends on the condition of the power amplifier. What is its saturation power, in which region you are working? So basically, if you see here, power amplifier at the lower power, it works linearly. As you keep increasing the power, after some times it becomes saturated. And after that, it is almost constant. So you can see from here, if you are increasing 1 dB power, but your signal was already here, this input power, you increase by 1 dB, so you will get your output increased by 1 dB because gain is constant, right? So whatever power you increased, it you can see at the P out. If you are working in this region, when it starts getting saturated, you can see from here, if you increase the power by 1 dB, it is not linear, so you will get less power because some of the power, because the nullity is going into neighboring channel. If you work in the complete saturation, let's say in this region, and you increase the power 1 dB here, you can see P out is almost constant. You will not be seeing much improvement there. So it all depends in which region you are actually working. Okay, so ideally, we want to work in the linear region. Practically, it depends where you are actually working. So if you can get 1 dB improvement by sending the 1 dB input power, it means you have a good power amplifier. It is a linear amplifier. So these were the questions which we have collected till yesterday. So now we will go to the chat box and we will see. Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. If there is any question, you may ask now. Okay. One question we received is that linearity is the necessity for any power amplifier. In which band L, S, C, K, U, K, etc. can I use the algorithm taught in the course? Is there any precaution while using in different band? So if you remember, we are working in the baseband level, means we are doing everything digitally. So all these algorithms which we are discussing here, they will be applicable easily in any of the bands, because these bands, they are defined by the up conversion stage, which is a mixer. So once you have made your signal in digital domain and your frequency domain shape is defined and your modulation is defined, everything is defined, after that these bands L, C, K, U, K, they just are defined by the mixer you are using and the frequency you have chosen. So mostly no, all these methods, algorithms will be effective in any of these bands. Only thing is that because as you go in higher in frequency, you experience more attenuation. So it is possible that the problem will change. Different kind of distortion you might be seeing, but the algorithm will be applicable and you can tune the coefficients basically. So, so Gaurav Poswal, he has asked, ma'am, how to calculate analog quadrature modulator problems? Okay, so do you mean that how you can see that there is any problem? Is this what you mean? It's in the real life, how you will know that is there any analog quadrature modulator problem or not? Is this what you are asking? So I didn't receive any answer. So I think I will answer whatever can be the feasible answers for that. First of all, when you are transmitting from any transmitter and you receive from a receiver, I have shown you via PPT that you will be having higher error because there is a signal hidden within the main signal. If you are having very poor EVM, poor NMC in-band error, then you might suspect that there is something wrong. So it is possible that some other signal is coming via your receiver interfering it, but it is also possible that your transmitter itself has the IQ imbalance. So how you can check, just for the sake of checking, you make a signal with the IF shift. It means whatever signal you have, you multiply it with e to the power j omega if t. So that omega if, you can choose 3 megahertz, 4 megahertz, whatever you can choose, that will be known to you because you are choosing it, right? So you multiply that signal with this sequence, with shifted version, send it via the same transmitter, and look at minus omega c location, is there anything appearing? If you are able to see a small signal appearing here, you will know that you have a IQ imbalance or analog quadrature modulator problems. Alternatively, suppose you cannot do this training signal and you have to identify based on whatever you are receiving. Means you have a transmitter receiver, but you cannot change anything. You can just get the data. So like I have said earlier, take your transmitted data, take your received data, time align them, and then plot their error in the frequency. Take their error, do its FFT. If their FFT is having a shape of a signal, it means it is a hidden signal. Because normally the errors are very, very small, small errors. If there is something coming from outside, it will appear in the error. So plot the frequency spectrum of the error and you will be able to see that something is hiding and most probably it is an image. So Madhuri Giminani has asked, what is the difference between cognitive radio and SDR? Is there any difference between the architecture? So I want to clarify here that SDR is the backbone of the cognitive radio. So SDR contains all the operations. It contains all the hardware, how to control that hardware. And if you want to give it any command for the cognitive radio, that has to be done in the SDR itself. So when we say cognitive radio, it is not a separate thing. When we say cognitive radio, the algorithms change. You use the SDR for the cognitive radio basically. So you will be having 3, 4, 5 SDRs, and based on the interaction of those SDRs, you will decide that how to use it for the cognitive radio applications. So basically, we can say that cognitive radio is the SDR plus extra intelligence. So you use the information by interaction and you use extra code, and SDR can be used for the cognitive applications. So to clarify, SDR is the backbone of the cognitive radio. Cognitive radio is where you're using extra algorithms only. Architecture does not change much. So is there any other questions? So, okay, one question is, any algorithm related to the hopping spectrum efficiency can we expect from you? So spectrum efficiency is covered here from the hardware point of view. It means when you are doing the coding in the modulation format, and then you are doing OFDM coding after that, then spectrum efficiency is covered. But the aspect of the cognitive radios, such as spectrum sensing, that is not covered in this course. that is entirely different aspect. What we will be covering here actually the power efficiency. That if you want to maintain the spectrum efficiency, then how to maintain the power efficiency at the same time. So again, this course is about software defined radios. It is about the architecture, but not the algorithm for the hopping or spectrum efficiency. When we say efficiency, it means you are talking about you've sensed the spectrum and then you jump to the spectrum. Those kind of things we are not covering here because that are the part of the networking. So that is not the part of this course. What you will be learning is what are the architecture and how can you can use the software defined radio in an efficient way. So in future we can extend into these directions, but not within this 10 hours. So yeah, thank you. Thank you very much for your comment. So people keep asking me that in the SDR we will be learning some software tricks, etc. What I found that mostly the people are from the communication background, they are from the micro background, and they don't interact with each other. So when I started, I thought that I will be covering the software aspects, but then I knew that there is no basics for those aspects. So these initial 10 hours, I have dedicated only for the hardware related things. So once it is understood by most of the people, maybe next year we will be floating some course, or next to next year we will be floating a course where we can cover the extra aspects also. Maybe we will be giving some coding examples also. So for we wanted to see how this course goes, and we are very thankful that all of you have attended this course very sincerely, and happy to see that people are taking interest in this kind of courses, which is the requirement of the country this time. So thank you for that. So if I'm waiting for some other questions also. So questions which we have received till yesterday, we have tried to cover in the PPT. Okay, any ebook for SDR? If you, okay, so one book is Skinnington. So if you go to the reference of our course, what is the exact, I think Software Defined Radios is the name of the book. By P.B. Kennington, and there are some other reference books there also. You can go, those are the books, they cover lots of the architecture. So the architectures which I have covered in this course, if you go there and you see, they are giving more details also, and some examples from the industry also. So if you want some free books, we will see, and we can post in the forum, because on top of it, I don't remember all the name of the free books. The books are available there. By the Software Defined Radio title, if you look for that, and they cover all these aspects. So again, I want to enforce, then these SDR kind of books, they will cover all these aspects only, okay, not cognitive radio, okay? But you will get more commercial aspects. One suggestion I want to make, because students, they keep asking me for the books. I will suggest if you can go for the application notes of the industries. So you look for some industries which provide you transmitter and receivers, and look for the application notes. They have some very good practical examples, and to explain those examples, they sometimes give you very, very good notes, better than some of the established books also. So go for the application notes also. I have taken some of the figures in my PPT earlier, which is from the NI. There's many, many companies which provide application notes these days, and they're very, written very simple and in a simple manner, and the mathematics, etc. It is very simple, and you are able to grasp it completely. Very practical kind of notes are there. Thank you. So about the analog quadrature modulator problem, these days, whenever you are going for any commercial kind of platform, mostly they give you those tuning parameters. So you can use SDR methods, which I have covered. I think you are already onto the assignment 4, and we are covering different models there, memory polymer, Volterra, etc. And you will find some of the models which are taking care of IQ imbalance also. So you can use those models for one step solution. Or what you can do is that I have shown you that there are two coefficients, K1, K2, in our slides earlier. You can tune them manually also. Also, it is not recommended, but you will see the effect of tuning, because there's basically only two components there. Yeah, so one question I received is that, how can I improve the BER performance using SDR? What are the parameters I should consider? So basically, when we are talking about the SDR, we have two components. One is transmitter, one is receiver. So when we are talking about NMSC and EVM, we are talking about the embed parameters, and they are deterministic in nature. It means you will be sending a fixed data and you will be comparing with the same kind of data. When we say BER, mostly it relates to the channel. It means your transmitter and receiver, they have a channel in between. The channel interacts with the data continuously. It is changing. It might have a multipath. A person passes between the transmitter and receiver. The parameter changes. So the BER, first of all, by using SDR can be improved by using pre-instruction techniques that improve the performance of the transmitter anyhow. So one method is that. Secondly, broadly speaking, you might have heard about the equalization algorithms and all the algorithms which are being used in receiver, they are part of the SDR basically. Because whatever is happening in the digital domain to extract the information, they will improve the BER. Moreover, the BER you have to take so many times because again, the channel is changing continuously. So to improve that in the transmitter side, you can use pre-distortion, but that can be used only for the distortion in the transmitter path. In the receiver side, whatever is the effect of channel, you can remove that by using the equalization algorithms. So I think I answered your question. What are the parameters I should consider? So when you are talking about the BER, I think parameters you should consider are the parameters of the channel basically. One of the main thing is that what is the SNR you're receiving at your receiver? How good is the power? So then again, power amplifier comes into the picture. Then the algorithm for the equalization. There are different equalization algorithms. So when you're talking about the parameters, you have to go into those algorithms, equalization techniques, basically, because they are dependent on the different channel parameters, like Grecian, Rayleigh, or if it is the LOS and only fading is there. So synchronization is one of the issues. Basically, when I'm giving you these lectures from the transmitter point of view, mostly a transmitter when I'm talking about pre-distortion and power amplifier. Excuse me. So in this case, what we are doing, you might have seen the demo in the lecture, that we synchronize my transmitter and receiver because we have the feedback receiver. It is with my transmitter itself, right? But when we are having a receiver which is far away, then synchronization is one of the issues. So then you have other problems like CFO, carrier frequency offset, at frequency which on which you are transmitting, it is not exactly at which it is receiving. It is shifted a little bit because of the path, multipath and everything and other parameters. So you have to synchronize at the same frequency. Then you will try to achieve your amplitude. So because the signal has been traveling for a long time through the channel, so it is attenuated. When it is received at the receiver, its power is very small. So you have automatic gain control in the receiver that will increase the power. And then when the power is in the range of ADC, then your ADC will down convert, and after that will apply your equalization and other techniques. So I hope that I answered your question here. Thank you for the question. So this course is mostly it covers transmitter and receiver aspect, but mostly it is tilted more towards the transmitter, and that is because there is not much covered on the transmitter side or the fabrication errors or what happens in the practical scenario. On the receiver side, you will find lots of literature. Most of the communication courses which you read in your undergrad or even in your postgraduate level. Mostly those courses, they focus on the receiver side because channel is always changing. It is more challenging. But thing is that the hardware imperfections, if you can improve those also. So you are making the path clear for the transmitter and receiver both. And then your performance improves automatically. So channel is one aspect, but this course is more toward the architecture of the SDR, how to improve the performance of the SDR if channel is not into the picture. When channel comes into the picture, it is entirely another game, and there is lots of literature for that also, and I think lots of communication courses also you can find on NPTEL or in the open literature also. So that is one of the aspect of this course that we are focusing more towards the transmitter here. Okay, one question I keep receiving. People keep asking if I will get, if I can provide any project based on this course. So I want to clarify here that sometimes we do have positions, sometimes we don't have positions, but it depends on the person to person basis and availability of the position. But the course in itself, it is very useful because it is a practical course. So if you go to any big telecommunication industry and you have hands on and you know the architecture and how to handle the measurement system of a transmitter and receiver, it is a very, very good kind of talent to have, because not everyone has it and it is not taught very easily in the colleges. So I think there you will benefit from this course. Whenever you handle any FPG based SDR system, which is easily available, they're low cost these days. So there you can learn something from this course and it will be useful in the practical scenario and sometimes for your job aspects also, if you are focusing for the communication industries. Okay, so one of the question Madhuri has asked again, how the architecture has been improved solving various problems? Can you please summarize, ma'am? So basically, when we started our course, we have gone with two main architectures, homodyne and heterodyne. The homodyne is the case where your carrier frequency is equal to your FLO, your LO frequency, up convergent frequency. So that is the smallest architecture. It is small in case, so you can put it on a chip easily. The problem which we find is that what I have shown you the IQ balance case, that sometimes when you have LO and RF at the same frequency, your IQ balance components will fall on top of each other. Moreover, if your LO is leaking directly to the RF path, then again, because RF at that frequency and LO is also at the same frequency, LO is hiding inside it. So homodyne has some problems. So we went to the heterodyne case. So in the heterodyne case, basically, you will be having a smaller frequency shift, FIF, what we say. Because of this FIF, now your FRF, FLO are different. And your IQ imbalance is also away from the FRF. So you can filter it out. What is the negative point? Negative point is that because you are using extra mixer, small FIF frequencies has to be given by some LO, right? So now the architecture becomes a little bit bigger and you are using two mixers, you are using two LOs. So heterodyne has some benefit over the homodyne, but now it is more complex. To improve upon the this problem of the heterodyne that it takes extra LO, extra mixers, we have NCOs, numerically controlled oscillators. What do? We do the FIF in the digital domain itself. Like in the example I told you earlier, that when you want to find out the IQ balance hiding, you multiply with e to the power j omega c t. So this multiplication with a small frequency, that can be done in the digital domain. So now your signal is actually far away from the FRF, but you didn't use any LO, you didn't use any mixer, shifted in the digital domain. How you are able to do this? Because the A to D and D to A, they are able to support a little bit wider bandwidth. So you can do the up conversion and even with the wider bandwidth, because your signal is far away from that zero IF here. So ADC has to capture all of that. So now we have digital IF, heterodyne system. It means we have only one LO, one mixer, and FIF is done in the digital domain. So this is how the architecture have been improved. So for example, you might have seen the demo in the last lecture. In that, we are using a FPGA-based system. So in that FIF is given by a digital tab. If you remember, if you can go back to the lecture and you can see that I'm showing some tabs and we can choose the IF frequency there. By choosing that IF frequency, I'm giving it a digital frequency offset of that FIF. But basically, we have the same one LO and one mixer for the up conversion. So that is the improved version, which is being used by the industries like TI, analog devices, etc. So I think to summarize it, we have three types of architecture: homodyne, heterodyne. Heterodyne has benefit over the homodyne. So we went to the digital IF based homodyne system. So Shilpa Ekwar is asking, can you suggest any simple project to start with SDR? So okay, if you say any simple project, I will say there are so many FPGA based RF systems available in the market. You simply go to the Google and look for the low cost RF solution. Take any simple system, try to transmit first of all single tone signal, receive it, then make a two tone signal, transmit it and receive it, and see how it is changing between the transmit and receiver path. So after that you can make more than two tones, 3, 4, 5 tones, which is in practical scenario it is a broadband system, and then you see how your output at the receiver is looking. Once you are able to see the problems in the system, then you can apply the algorithm which I have shown in this course and try to improve the performance of those things. So a simple project will be transmitting and receiving successfully, first of all, I will say. Then you will have the understanding of the problem, and then you will try to target the solution. How to take the values of interpolation and decimation values and rational resampling in TX, RX side? Okay. So basically, on the platforms which I have used commercially, mostly they are defined by the company itself because they are FPGA system. So they have this ratio. You can choose among this ratio for the interpolation and decimation. So if you have to send a broadband signal, so of course you want to favor the interpolation case because you want to do the oversampling. If it is not that much high bandwidth signal, you can go with the normal sampling rate also. But in most of the cases, it will be fixed by the company. So for example, which the one you have seen, the TI based setup we have shown in the demo, it takes 4 times of oversampling. It means the sampling frequency is also fixed by their local oscillators, and it is 307.2 megahertz sampling frequency. 4 times is the option, highest option, so we take 4 times of that as a oversampling option. So again, Sai Sunil, you are asking what is the difference between software-defined radio and cognitive radio. I already replied to earlier, the architecture is same because architecture contains analog components and software techniques. In cognitive radio, you have extra intelligence because you are constantly interacting with the transmitter and receiver, and based on that interaction, then you are infusing extra intelligence. And it is mostly to do with the networking and how you sense that a spectrum is empty or not. Software-defined radio is basically radio. It is hardware portion and how you drive that hardware. And cognitive radio is the SDR plus extra intelligence based on the interaction between the other receiver, users, other transmitters, etc. Thank you. Thank you for your questions. So, thank you all of you. Okay, so I just got one more question. Is there any workshop held at your college? So, actually, we hold a workshop periodically in my college. We also give lectures to the commercial companies. For Bell, we have done the lectures earlier. And we have an ICT Academy here. They keep doing some of the lectures here. If you go to the site of IIT Roorkee, you will find many workshops here. So you can go there and you can choose which one you like. So thank you for all of your comments. And if you still have some comments, we have our forum open there. You can put the question and we will try our best to solve it. I have just one request to make, that if you want to get any answer, at least give it 24 hours to us to answer it properly, because your examinations are coming for most of you people. So in that case, I will say at least 24 hours before your exams, you ask us so that we can reply in time. So thank you very much. With this, I think we will be closing the session, but we will be active on the forum. Thank you very much.